committee is asking for potted spring flowers to adorn the altar for Easter Sunday, so I believe that you'll be doing that right after the service, right?
No, tomorrow morning.
Oh, tomorrow morning, okay. So obviously they'd like the flowers before tomorrow morning, okay? Or tomorrow morning, just come and help, okay? And then there will be a congregational business meeting April 24th, 9:15 a.m. Membership matters will be discussed and preparing for the new pastor and also reports will be given. And then if you're not getting the electronic newsletter, please let me know about that. We'll put you on the list. That electronic newsletter comes out every week, usually on Saturday. So if you're not getting it, then I probably don't have your email. So please give that to me, and then you'll be a subscriber. Okay, so that concludes our opening announcements. The program for this Tenebrae service is in your hands, hopefully. A lot of you have attended these services before. The darkness symbolizes the judgment of God. So we think of the fact that Jesus Christ bore that judgment. Otherwise, it would be us. So we have a lot to be thankful for on this Good Friday. So our first nocturne begins on page 2, and we'll begin with first hymn, Jesus I Will Ponder Now. That's hymn 420 in your blue hymnals. God bless your worship this afternoon.
Spirit, be in us.
Will the congregation please rise? The invocation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, help us to remember your Son's suffering and death, so that we may be filled with thankfulness for the forgiveness of sins and redemption from everlasting death, which we have through him. Grant us such steadfast faith that we may no longer fear the power of our adversaries and the power of death. We commend our whole family, for whom our Lord saw fit to suffer death upon the cross, into your hands for safekeeping, both now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins to God and ask for his forgiveness. Almighty God, merciful Father, I confess to you that I have not loved you with all my heart. I have pursued my ways instead of your ways, in what I have done and left undone. I have not loved other brothers and sisters as myself. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. I am truly sorry for my sins. I repent of them. I beg your mercy.
The Almighty God has been merciful to us and has sent his Son to die for all. For his sake, he forgives us all our sins and calls us from darkness to his marvelous light. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please remain standing for Psalm 22.
Cast into
This time the choir will sing the verse of the day, the congregation may be seated.
Come the darkest day.
Remember our Lenten theme, the sentences that Jesus Christ spoke from the cross. There are seven of them all told, and now we come on this Good Friday to the last sentence. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And when he said this, he breathed his last. In the name of our dear Savior, Jesus Christ, dear fellow believers, I think one of the trends of modern society that upsets you as well as me is the whole idea of not having a funeral. You've certainly observed this, right? That many times someone will be passed away in the community, and you're kind of looking around, well, when is the funeral? Where is the funeral? And you read and you find out that there's no funeral. They've let that loved one who's passed away just kind of pass away. There's no memorial service, there's no service in the church, there's no funeral dinner, there's nothing. And I think that just as a commentary in our society, that our society is falling away. We are becoming less and less Christian. People who study our society say that we are in the post-Christian era. Maybe you've heard that, the post-Christian era. And so if you're living in a post-Christian era, it almost doesn't make sense to have a funeral, because what do you say? What do you know? Someone who's not a Christian doesn't know anything about the afterlife. They can't say anything with positivity. They can't say anything for sure about what happened to that person that passed away. It's a whole different thing with us Christians, isn't it? And it's different because of today. It's different because Jesus died. Jesus died for our sins, and that changes absolutely everything. Now death is not something to fear. Now death is perfectly safe for you and for me. And it's all because of the death of Christ. So today we have the privilege of looking at the very last words that Jesus Christ spoke before he died. "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." So we're going to borrow that from our Savior Jesus as our sermon theme for today. "Father, in your hands, I commit my spirit." And we're going to make some observations of those dear words of our Savior. We observe three things. First of all, he calls God his Father. Secondly, he has a childlike faith. And then thirdly, he knows where he's going. So first of all, we see that he calls God his Father, so that's very obvious. The sentence starts that way. I won't put it on the screen again. He says, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." So Jesus calls God his Father. Can we say the same thing? Can we say that God is our Father? If we think about our sins, we might have doubts about that. And today's subject, the death of Jesus Christ, really amplifies our sins. Jesus Christ did not shy away from pain. When God assigned him to suffer, he willingly suffered. Is that the way you are? Is that the way I am? Certainly not always, and certainly very rare. At least in my case, when I suffer, I don't complain or blame it on somebody. Is that the way you are? When you suffer, you blame it on somebody, you blame it on the government,
You blame it on your spouse, you blame it on your kids, you blame it on your parents. Jesus wasn't like that. He was holy and pure. He was sinless, but we aren't. And so that brings us back to that same question. Can we really call God our Father? Are we really in His family? Yes, we can. All we need to do is remember the death of Jesus Christ. That was the purpose for Christ coming into this world, and that was to die for our sins. Now, our whole Lenten season, we've been looking at how Jesus Christ suffered for our sins. He suffered in being beaten. He suffered in being whipped. He suffered in being nailed to that cross. He suffered when he was insulted by all of the godless unbelievers that were at the foot of the cross. But the main payment for our sin was death. Maybe you remember this passage in the Bible from the Romans. The wages of sin is death. See? So in order for Jesus Christ to make complete payment for our sins, he had to die. And now he is there hanging on the cross. All the suffering is done. He's completed that part of the payment. He has completed all the prophecies that were predicted in the Bible, things that he would do in his earthly life. That's all predicted, or that's all completed, I should say. And now one thing remains, and that is for him to complete the payment by dying. And notice how he dies. Let me read the text again. Jesus called out with a whimper. Jesus called out with a whisper. No, Jesus called out with a loud voice. So there was plenty of energy in the life of Jesus Christ. And when he knew the time was right, when he knew that he had done all the suffering and one thing was left, he just willed himself to be dead. A different kind of a death than any other man ever suffered. Now, that kind of death we look at with mixed emotions, don't we? Mixed emotions. First of all, it's mixed because we know that it was our sins that put him there. It was our lies and our lust and our love for ourself and our countless other sins of thought, word, and deed. We are the ones who put Jesus Christ on that cross. You imagine that body all ripped up with a Roman whip, his back being just ribbons of bleeding flesh. You look at that body hanging there on the cross with the nails through the hands and the feet. Who did the damage? Who did the damage? You did. You did. And I did with our many, many sins. So we are sad today. We're going to be leaving church in total silence and darkness. And that's fitting. We should be sad. But we should also be very, very happy because Jesus died. Jesus died, and that means that he completed the payment for our sins. All of our sins are completely paid for. God doesn't look down on us now, and he doesn't say, those dirty, rotten sinners, they owe me a lot, and they never paid me anything for those sins. God doesn't view us that way anymore. He views us as spotless and pure. He views us as people who are adoptable. And indeed, he has adopted us. He adopted us in baptism, the waters of baptism. And that's why we have this passage from Galatians chapter 3, verse 26. You are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. So can we call God our Father? Absolutely. We can call him our dear and loving Father. We are his dear children because of the death of Jesus Christ. We call God our Father, and this leads us to point number two, a childlike faith. And we see a very good example of that in Jesus Christ, our Savior. He has a childlike faith. A childlike faith that prepared him for death. I'll never forget this. It was early in my ministry. I think it was maybe year two or three. And I had been called. Someone just called me on the phone and said, our dad is dying. Can you come and see him? I didn't know this individual. He wasn't a member of our little church at the time.
So I went over there to the house, and they lived down there by, close to where you live, Carrie Shale, on that road. What is that road anyway?
Forest.
Forest Road, right. My mind went blank. So we lived on Forest Road. So went over to the house, and all the family's in the living room. The dying person is alone in a bedroom. So I go into the bedroom, and I didn't know what to do, so I just started sharing my faith with them. I asked him if he believed in Jesus. He said, yeah. He answered all the questions. He died as a believer. So then I was asked to do the funeral. And the funeral was at the funeral home, Sommenstrasser Funeral Home, the name of it at the time. And I just began the little funeral service, and the widow comes right up out of her seat. She marches up to the coffin, and she bangs on the coffin with her hand like this. She called out the name of her husband. And she says, why did you leave me? Why did you have to die? Why did you leave me? Why did you die? And then she just broke down in tears. She was just, she had completely lost it. This woman was not prepared for death. She was not prepared for the death of her husband. And needless to say, she would not have been prepared for her own death either. She was not prepared because she didn't have this childlike faith. Jesus Christ had a childlike faith. He says, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. It's obvious that he has this childlike faith that when it comes to death, he's just going to put himself completely at the will of his Heavenly Father and trust in his Heavenly Father. Now, I know what you're probably saying. You're saying, well, that's easy for Jesus to do. He's perfect. He's holy. He does everything right. But remember what he'd gone through. Jesus had been not just disciplined for the sins of the world, he had been punished for the sins of the world, and punished hard. And then remember that he was forsaken by God the Father just a few moments ago. He cried out in agony, my God, why have you forsaken me? I think we've all seen this, or maybe even done this. You fathers, you take your little child who's maybe 2 years old, 3 years old, and, or am I the only one who's done this? You take this child and you throw him in the air. Don't forget to catch him. That's critical, okay? You throw him in the air and you catch him. Throw him in the air and you catch him. What is the kid doing? Is the kid having a good time? They're having a great time, okay? They're just loving it, smiling, giggling. But what if you would drop the child once? Then it's the end of the game. Then it's cry. Then it's tears, right? So Jesus had been dropped. He had been dropped. He had been dropped into the agony of hell just a few moments ago. And now it's time for him to die. Is he going to be able to die with a childlike faith? He does die with a childlike faith. He does. How does he do that? Well, Jesus had been a student of the scriptures. Even when he was 12 years old, he had this amazing knowledge of the scriptures. And he studied the life of the Messiah, the life of the promised Savior. He studied the death of the promised Savior. And he knew that it would be bad, it would be horrible, it would be hellish for a while, but it would just be temporary. And then at the very end, God would turn back and show grace and mercy on the Messiah. A very well-known passage, a passage that every Jewish boy had to memorize, Isaiah 53, verse 11. After the suffering of his soul, he, the Messiah, will see the light of life and be satisfied. So Jesus had that childlike faith that just simply said, as bad as this is, and as bad as that was, everything is going to turn out okay. Can you die with a childlike faith? Bear in mind that for you it's going to be even more favorable, much more favorable than it was for Jesus. Jesus had to bear the punishment for sin. You will never have to bear the punishment for even one sin. Never. Because Jesus bore that punishment. Furthermore, you have the promise from your good and gracious God that he'll never leave you. Never leave you in life. Never leave you in death. Never leave you for an eternity. I have some beautiful passages here in my sermon notes. Hebrews 13:5. Never will I leave you. Never will I forsake you. Again, Matthew 28:20.
I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. And it's because of these kinds of promises that King David, a long time ago in Psalm 23, said, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me." You are with me. A childlike faith. Remember that. Desire that. How do we get a childlike faith? We just decide, I want a childlike faith? Does it work that way? No, it doesn't work that way. God in His grace and mercy gives us a childlike faith through His word and sacraments. So the more you hear God's word, the more you receive the sacrament of Holy Communion, then the more this childlike faith develops inside you. That's something really to want. That's something to desire. That's something to pray for. A childlike faith prepares you perfectly for your own death. And with a childlike faith, we know where we're going. And that's the way it was with Jesus. He knows where He's going after death. He's not confused in any way, shape, or form. In our text for this sentence that he says, our text for this afternoon, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." So Jesus here is talking about his soul. He knows that his body is going to be put into a tomb for 3 days. But he knows that his soul is going to be with God the Father for safekeeping. Now in the case of Jesus, it was just for 3 days. 3 days, that soul goes to be with the Father. And then after 3 days, then Jesus takes possession again of his soul. But he knew where he was going. He knew where his real self, his soul, was going. And that was into the loving, caring, safe, strong hands of the Father. Can you say the same thing? Do you know where you are going? The unbeliever says you can't know. You can't know. You Christians can't know. Because the unbeliever bases everything on human experience. And so the unbeliever says, you've never interviewed anybody who came back from death. You've never come back from death. You've never died and come back to life again. That's never happened to you, not really. So you can't know. And our response to that is, there's some things, in fact, the most important things, that you cannot know from human experience. You can only know from God's word. Jesus says in his word, John 16, "I came from the Father and entered the world, and now I'm leaving the world and going back to the Father." Again, he says in John chapter 2 to his disciples, "In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am." And notice that in these words of Jesus in the scriptures, there's absolutely no uncertainty. Jesus doesn't say, "I have a theory," or "this is what I think might happen after death." He tells us in no uncertain terms what's going to happen to our soul the instant we die. We will be in the Father's hands. The Father's wonderful, safe, loving hands. Long time ago, there was this little boy. He went to a church picnic. Not talking to telling a story about myself, but a little buddy of mine, Dickie Conn, went to a church picnic, and there he ran some games, and he won a prize. And one of his prizes was a 1964 U.S. quarter, which in 1964 was worth 25 cents. But at that time, it was worth significantly more. I don't know, maybe $10, $15. But Dickie was a little bit of a coin collector, and so he was pretty excited about this. And he's showing his friends, and one of his friends says, "Aren't you kind of worried you're going to lose that? I mean, this is a church picnic. We're going to go swimming later. Aren't you afraid you're going to lose that?" And Dickie says, "I'm not afraid. I'm going to give this to my Father. I'm going to give this to my Father for safekeeping. He'll keep it. He won't lose it." And that's the same attitude that you and I have too. A lot of unknowns. when it comes to death. We think of, you know, what's heaven going to be like? What's it going to be like being in heaven just with my soul and not my body? Okay? But one thing we know for sure, and that is that we will be in the hands of God the Father, and you can't be in better hands than His. Dear friends, all the events of the life of Christ are recorded basically in four books in the Bible. You're aware of that, of course, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. If you were to add up all those chapters of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you would come up with a number 89. So there's 89 chapters that tell us about the life of Christ. 49 describe His death. 49. Isn't that something? 89 chapters tell us about Jesus. 49 have to do with the events leading up to His death and death itself. And that really tells us something about the Christian faith. The Christian faith is all about a death of Jesus Christ. But it's a good death. It's the best death. Because that death enables us to call God our Father. It's because of that death that we have this childlike faith. It's because of that death that we know where we're going when we die. Amen. Will the congregation please rise? And we will respond to the sermon today with the sermon response on the bottom of page 3, hymn 436, verse 7. Second Nocturne, page 4.
you're following along in our program, the second doctrine, page 4. The first scripture reading from Luke chapter 23. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." We respond with hymn 428, verse 1. At him, "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus answered him, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." We respond with verse 2. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And when he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion, seeing what had happened, praised God and said, "Surely this was a righteous man." When all the people who had gathered to witness this sight saw what took place, they beat their breasts and went away. But all who knew him, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things. Verse 3.
Sorrow, your pity will
Now there was a man named Joseph, a member of the council, a good and upright man, who had not consented to their decision and action. He came from the Judean town of Arimathea, and he himself was waiting for the kingdom of God. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen cloth, and placed it in a tomb cut in the rock, one in which no one had yet been laid. It was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Then they went home and prepared spices and perfumes, but they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment. Verse 4. Who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
He was humble and walked the path of obedience all the way to death, his death on the cross. This time the Christ candle is being removed by our usher to symbolize the death of Jesus Christ. Pray. God most holy, look with mercy on this your family for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed, to be given over into the hands of the wicked, and to suffer death upon the cross. Keep us always faithful to him, our only Savior, who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. We join our hearts and voices in the prayer that our Savior taught us. Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom,
the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. This time the Christ candle is being returned in anticipation of the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ on Sunday morning. And Mr. Melville, our usher, will excuse you row by row. Remember, please, to leave in silence.